Why do humans get goosebumps? We're gonna answer that question in today's video and even talk about what causes goosebumps by going over some of the relevant anatomy. So we'll take a look at real human skin and even a real human brain to discuss the brain's involvement in this phenomenon that we call goosebumps. And more importantly, do goosebumps do us any good? We're gonna have to compare ourselves to some of our furry little cousins, the mammals, in order to answer that question. So let's do this. So why the name goosebumps? Well, when your skin raises up and creates those bumps, it resembled the skin of a goose when the feathers were plucked. And those spots where the feathers were located had these little bumps or protrusions, hence the name goosebumps. And speaking of skin, let's take a look at some real skin to discuss the relevant anatomy to these goosebumps. So this is a dissection from the mid-back of a cadaver. I'm probing the top layer of the skin, and we refer to this layer as the epidermis. Now this is obviously the layer where we'd see the bumps or the goosebumps try to push into or create the protrusions, but we also need to talk about the second layer. The second layer here, the majority of this cut edge is referred to as the dermis. So the paper thin top is the epidermis, but then the thicker portion here is the dermal tissue. Now the dermal tissue is really relevant, or this layer is extremely relevant, because it's going to contain some very important structures that have to do with goosebumps. So let's zoom into this area with our model here. So here is our anatomical model of the skin, a really zoomed in version of what we were looking at on the skin dissection just a second ago. And let me just orient you to this model. From here to here is the epidermis. Yeah, you can see some different colors, and the epidermis does have some sublayers associated with it. That's for a different video. For our purposes, here to here is the epidermis. And then from here to here is the dermis, or the dermal tissue. And this is where the majority of the magic is gonna happen in our goosebump story, in the dermal tissue. And we have to talk about the hairs, because when we get involved in goosebumps, you talk about people's hair standing up, but goosebumps are going to be associated with these structures called hair follicles. And here is the anatomy of a hair follicle. FYI, follicle just means little bag. Think of it as a little bag for hair to grow out of. And the hair follicle in the current state is, you can see at this angle right here, kind of at an angle that's less than 90 degrees there, slanting up like so. But there is something extremely important that is associated with these hair follicles that helps us understand goosebumps. And that is this structure here. And this is actually a muscle called the erector pili muscle. Erector just means it's gonna lift. Pili refers to hair. So take a look at this relationship here. I've got a hair follicle slanted at this angle, and I've got this erector pili muscle here. You can see it attaches to the upper portion of the dermis, but then down to the base of the hair follicle. Now, when this muscle contracts, take a look. It'll contract and pull like so, and when it pulls the base of the follicle, it goes like, makes that sound effect too, and straightens the hair up and down, and will also create a little bump or protrusion kind of pushing up into the dermal tissue, because we're getting that swooping and kind of pushing upward to create the goosebumps, and the hairs will stand up straight. Now, one other really important point about this muscle called the erector pili muscle. This is what we refer to as a smooth muscle. There's different types of muscle tissue in the human body. The muscles we're used to working out at the gym, like the biceps, that's a skeletal muscle that we can voluntarily move whenever we want to. But smooth muscles, like the one that we're seeing right here called the erector pili muscle, are involuntary, meaning we can't choose to control them. Now, I do think it would be pretty awesome if we could control all the erector pili muscles whenever we wanted to. Could you imagine we kind of just like, and all your hair goes poof all at once? That would be pretty cool. Unfortunately for nerds like me, that just doesn't occur. So if goosebumps, or in other words, the activation of this erector pili muscle, are involuntary, what causes it to occur? Well, typically, this is activated through either a physiological stress, such as exposure to cold, or even an emotional stress, such as anger, fear, or other strong emotions. And there's this amazing structure in the brain that gets involved in regulating such emotions, and that is this structure in the central core of the brain, referred to as the hypothalamus. And just to orient you guys, you probably got an idea, this is a sagittal cut or a midline cut through the brain. And again, the hypothalamus located underneath my probe in the central core. Now, the hypothalamus does a lot of things, like I said, involved in emotions, also involved in homeostasis, but it also gets involved in regulating this part of the autonomic nervous system called the sympathetic nervous system. Autonomic, again, just refers to automatic, involuntary control. But the sympathetic nervous system often gets nicknamed the fight or flight system because it releases a neurotransmitter or a chemical referred to as noradrenaline or norepinephrine. Those are the same things, just a different name for the same chemical that's closely related to adrenaline or epinephrine. So let's take you through a little sequence or an example of this. The hypothalamus, processing strong emotions or physiological stress or distress, creates a sympathetic response. The signal will essentially go down the spinal cord and make it to the thoracic region and then send impulses out to nerves to go to specific targets throughout the body. One of those specific targets being in the skin here. It would take maybe this little nerve impulse here and release norepinephrine or noradrenaline onto the receptors of this erector pili muscle, causing it to activate, boom, hair starts to stand up. So let's just go a little bit further with that example. All of us have been cold and then gotten goosebumps. Now, when you got those goosebumps when you were cold, did you all of a sudden think, wow, these goosebumps have made me really warm? It just doesn't happen like that for us. And the reason is we've lost a ton of hair when we compare ourselves to our ancestors or some of our cousins, such as the mammals, which are covered in a whole bunch of fur. And in that case, for them, these goosebump muscles or erector pili muscles are essential. And let me illustrate why that's so important for our furry little friends here. When the erector pili muscle contracts and the hairs start to stand up more upright, that creates these little pockets where dead or stagnant air starts to fill. And creating little pockets of stagnant air that's not moving around very much is one of the most efficient forms of insulation. We do it all the time with windows. A double pane window is much more efficient than a single pane window. Pane, dead air space, and a second pane, and that really stops heat from leaving the home. Same idea when you have these little dead air spaces that are formed by all the fur, creating those little air pockets, really stops heat from leaving the body of the animal. Now that takes care of the response to cold, but what about this anger and fear response? Now, you've probably seen a dog or a wolf or another ferocious creature get mad and show its teeth and snarl, and on a dog it almost looks like their spine's popping out of their back. That has nothing to do with their spine. We often refer to it as hackles, but the fur from the erector pili muscle starts to stand up, and that makes the animal look larger and more intimidating to keep enemies away. Now, again, I think it'd be cool if we could do it, although I don't really know if people would be running for the hills if we all of a sudden had our hair on our arm or our legs just pop out like we're trying to scare somebody away, but it would still be nerdy and kind of cool. So in other words, for us, not much of a function for this erector pili muscle or the creation of goosebumps. It's kind of this lost function that we lost through years and years and years of evolution and loss of hair. And now we clothe ourselves and pack ourselves in houses and do other things to keep ourselves warm. But it also kind of explains those times where you might get goosebumps from other strong emotions, like maybe you heard a song that you really liked and those triggered emotional centers in your hypothalamus. Or maybe you watched this really inspiring anatomy video and you all have goosebumps because of everything we've just talked about. If you want to have a greater understanding of the human body and how various structures such as muscles, nerves, and blood vessels and other things interact with each other, it's best to kind of think of the human body as a puzzle or multiple puzzle pieces interacting with each other to create this huge thing that we call the human body. And that's why I'm such a big fan of Brilliant. Brilliant is a problem-solving website focused on math and science, but it teaches you to become a better problem solver through pattern recognition and just use of logic. Developing a scientific mind where you can ask the right questions, critically think and analyze, and solve problems is one of the best skills that you can develop. Brilliant can help you to further develop these skills by diving deep into subject matter such as engineering, chemistry, physics, and mathematics, and that can carry over into other subjects. I always used to tell students, and still do, you want to learn how to learn. And wherever you learn and become better problem solvers in other subjects, it will carry over into things like anatomy, physiology, and other scientific topics. So if you are interested in this, go to brilliant.org/Institute of Human Anatomy or go to the link in our description, and Brilliant will give the first 200 people 20% off their annual membership. And while you're down in that description, go ahead and comment, like, subscribe, and we'll see you in the next video.